Who knows what this sign is? The image.
Mondrian.
Mondrian, yes. Mondrian has a specific art which is seen by some as simple, because he takes MS Paint, draws some lines, some fills, and you have a new painting. At that time, it wasn't that simple. And it was a new movement, and this type of art exists for 100 years now, so it's a while ago. But still, when I'm seeing it, I'm thinking, wow, it looks nice. It has the primary colors, and at the same time, it's, it's simple, and it still has something to it. I live in a small village near Den Bosch, in the southern part of the Netherlands, and what you see in the Netherlands now is that some areas, especially the newer areas, that they reuse some types of art. And this type is usually, or is commonly used as well. So the area where I live, we see a lot of red, blue, and yellow.
Your t-shirt?
Yeah, that's a coincidence. I was looking in the mirror this morning, and I thought, well, I should only have had yellow on top of it, and then it was complete. But I'm a board member for the ENLUG, so I have different roles. Also today, but also for our community. And it's an interesting one that I try to help the organization to be more active. So it's nice to see that we have increased numbers today. I have my own company, which is called Cisofi, and that focuses specifically on security. And one of the reasons to do this talk is that security solutions are usually not simple. They have a lot of complications with them because of what people want to achieve is usually not in line with security. They want to protect things, but the typical user, they rather don't want to have a password of 16 characters. They don't want to change it every month. They don't want to use two-factor authentication. So security is an interesting one in that it has simplicity, or it needs simplicity, but it doesn't have it. So with Cisofi, I try to make changes in that so that you can use software more easily. One of the tools we have is Linus, an open source tool. It exists for 10 years now. I actually gave a presentation at the conference here as well about it. And what I tried to do in the last years is just focus on simplicity. So the first time when you use it, you don't have to find out, okay, what switches do I need to use? Where do I need to install it? The configuration file itself, what do I need to change? But you should be able to use the software from the first minute. And what you see in still many tools is that it's not the case. I will show some examples today. If you have any questions, by the way, you can just in between, just raise your hand and we do them in between. So today we look at what simple is. It's a simple word, but what does it really mean? In my abstract, I said, let's challenge complexity. I think Jane did a good job this morning explaining that some systems are not easy and that they have even some magic in them. And last, to see what we can do in our own work, in our tools, in our own usage, what we can do to simplify your own life. We are a bunch of sheep, so sorry to do the insult, but when it comes to complexity, we typically accept it. We say, if I need to do this, I accept that I need to do these steps. And we rarely fight or rebel against it and say, no, this should be easier. We all know, like, the tax stuff every year, it's getting easier and easier, but still, it's a lot of steps. And what we see with software is that we accept things as they are. So, I like to clear, talk on the billboard saying, well, I'm going to eat you. I will promise today I will not eat you, so
I will not. Can you trust you?
I'm not sure about that. That part you will find out then. So I said I have something with Mondrian, as in that I like the style itself, and it's also called the style. Another thing of simplicity, and I think most people will recognize this image. It's an old advertisement of Apple, about the Apple II. And just by their early focus on keeping things simple, everyone knew directly, what it was. Instead of saying, we make a nice computer, no, they didn't care about that. They wanted to sell you a dream, say, your life will be easier, or you will get nice things out of it, which you otherwise won't get. And just by keeping a simple ad like this, I think that they do a good job. I'm not a Mac or Apple fanboy. I have actually a MacBook. It's for presentations, so that I know that it actually works. So that's a little bit ironic. But what I like about the Apple branding is that simplicity is an important thing in their design, in their website. If you go to their website, you will not get lost. Maybe if you are in some knowledge base article, but if you say, I want to buy a notebook, you don't have to click 10 times, you can find it very easily. So that's an interesting one. And with their advertisements, they try to achieve the same, and I think they do a good job in that. And the MacBook, this is a model of last year, but the MacBook Pro, when they still had some more ports and even audio. I got only USB-C, so I have these kind of strange dongles attached to it. I'm not sure if that's getting simpler, the device is getting simpler, but for me it's not getting easier. So, but if you see the device itself, you think, okay, it's a good design. It has not strange edges or strange things. It took a lot of time to do it correctly. It looks simple, but if you want to design something simple, it isn't that easy. This is an interesting one because this is the same device, but with a different kind of way of thinking. So, when I was young, we had a remote control which had actually an opening part which you can, I'm not sure what the English word is, a clef. And you got even more buttons because they didn't want to put them at the bottom, otherwise you would be pressing them all the time. But there were so many buttons on it that I didn't know what they were used for. And still, the left version of Philips, it's not that bad. But still, if you would, you could still reduce a lot of things. And Apple took it to the extreme. They said, just some rotating thing and some things you can press and a play and a pause, which is most likely enough. And the rest you can do with the software. You don't need all the buttons for it. So this is a good example of making things easier.
You can't turn it off unless your television is on.
You can turn it off?
You can't turn it off unless your television is actually on so you can see what's on the screen.
Sure.
That is the back door.
That's the dependency. Sure. also about KISS, that's something I have in here. It's an interesting one because it says, keep things simple. The comma is an interesting one because originally it was not there, It said, keep it simple, stupid. And now it looks like the stupid, if we are stupid, or you should make it for stupid people. But I don't think that's the background of it. But the principle itself, well, it says keep things simple. And that's, I think, a good thing. I got one from Mr. Dijkstra. And I think it's a strong one, because if you Google for these kind of quotes, you will find many. But some really go to the point where it makes sense. And when I look at security, for example, every piece of complexity in it will also make sure that it's harder to maintain, it might be less reliable, the availability issues might show up. So keeping things simple will also indicate that you have smaller components to maintain, so that you better understand what they are doing. And if you understand each individual component, you most likely can better maintain it. It's like the ants in Jane's story. It's easier to see what one ant is doing than if you have, well, the full nest of ants, because you see all kind of things happening and it's hard to comprehend what's happening, what's really happening. And this is an interesting one, because we humans are programmed to take the shortest route, the easiest route. We are lazy in a way, we want to save energy. And by keeping things simple, we can also take the shortest path. And that's a good thing to save energy itself, but also to achieve more. Because if you have a lot of complexity in your software or in your interfaces you're using, it most likely means every single additional click is just a waste of time. So if you have a shorter part, like the Apple website, if you can order your new notebook in just 3 clicks, or like Amazon in 1 click, then most likely more people will actually buy something from you. And if you first have to look and search and do all kind of steps, then most likely you say, I still want to think about it. Or, and if you have just the 1 click button, most likely after the fact you get a regret, but then they already have your order. Agile, I guess most heard about it. This is more the programming background, but it's, if you first look at simplicity is essential, you might think, okay, but why is that? And you would normally say, okay, we want to save time, we want to take the shortest route, but it's also good to think about the reverse and say, well, any steps that are unneeded or are just a waste of time. If you go into lean IT and lean manufacturing processes, you will also find out that every single step and every single process is analyzed to see where are we doing things that are, well, just waste. And actually this is saying the same. Let's try to get rid of the most of the waste, so that the things we are doing, this is more efficient. Well, this is more a very common one, and especially for this audience, we all know the more tooling and the less command, and for some reason the less command came after more, and it is better because you can scroll back, so less is better.
No, there's most.
Oh, is there most?
Yes.
Oh, nice. Now let's talk also about complexity, because simplicity, okay, let's say we understand why we want to make things easier, because saving time, saving energy, but complexity is everywhere. But we have some hate, love with complexity, and that's also interesting. If you look at this, and I'm not sure if the colors are correctly seen, these are fractals. Fractals are in geometry, kind of spirals, and then calculated little pieces, and if you repeat that, you get all kind of sort of arcs. And when you see them, you typically will say, "Oh, well, that looks nice." Not sure if you can do anything with it, but it's like every piece of art. It might look nice, and if you look into it, you can see all kind of different things. Sometimes it's just, you look at the colors, sometimes you look at the forms and how they get smaller and smaller. And this is another one. So what they try to do is combine the smallest piece of forms and create bigger ones. And it's complex in a way, but looks pretty, right? Who thinks it's not pretty? No one? Okay. Now one more. Yeah. What would you say that this is?
Flower.
Flower, yeah. That is a fractal, but at the same time, we recognize things in it, and that's also interesting. But this is complexity in a way that we like it. So sometimes we hate complexity, like our text forms filling in, and all the many questions you have to answer. But when looking at these kind of things, we can actually take time for it and say, "Oh, we appreciate it." Another type of complexity, and this is the one we dislike, is when we have choice. Because we like to have choice, but at the same time, if you have too much choice, then we start to dislike it. So if you go to the HP website, we say,
"You always get Windows."
I like, sorry?
You always get Windows.
You always get Windows, yeah, so that's easy. That's an easy choice. But then you say, "Okay, I want a nice notebook, I want to use it for work, for example." Then you say, "Okay, the Omen, the first one, it's for gaming, that's not really needed." But then you get the Elite book, it's for traveling, it's easy because you have to bring it to Europe. But then there's the Elite book with the new and innovative security solutions. Well, it sounds good to have, so let's take that one. But then there's one with the artisan materials and striking craftsmanship. I mean, I'm sorry, I want that one. But wait, I want those other functions as well. Okay, so, but then you have the one at the right, built for performance. Now maybe you have to do some graphic stuff or other. So you want also the performance. So in the end, you think, whatever choice you make, and especially if you like the touchscreen on the left button, then it becomes even more complicated. But whatever choice you make, you fail in the end, because you always make the wrong choice, because you always wanted some features of the art. But this is actually the bad choice, or actually bad complexity by having too much choice. Now, I said Apple, they take it easier for you, and they said, we're not giving you too much choices up front. Just say, what kind of user are you? And if you just look at the notebooks, because they have, of course, all kind of different devices on top of it. But if you look at the notebooks, you have three types. The normal MacBook, like I have. The Air, the thin one, although it's as thin as this one now. And the MacBook Pro for the heavier, more business type of users. So you get easier to the point that you say, okay, I'm a business user, so I go for the MacBook Pro, my boss is paying, so nice, and you go for that one. You only have to decide if you want all the options, and you tell it to your boss, and he says, no, it's already an expensive thing, so you go with the first one. But your number of choices are less, and at the same time you made a decision where you think, this is the right notebook for me, so I'm happy with it. Anyone using that strange little LED-based thing on this MacBook? No? It's a nice feature. Speaking about choices, if you look at software, we have the same issue. And this is an NMAP. Well, common port scanner, very old, very matured in the meantime. But if you're going to do to use this for the very first time, I had no idea what to do. So I thought, okay, I need to give it a scan type, and options, and a target. Target, okay, that's the network or an IP address, so that's maybe the easiest part. But the scan type, and actually I couldn't find what I should provide, because where are the types? So I had to use the man page, and say, yeah, well, that's why we have the man pages, so that you can put a lot of stuff on the screen, but if you don't understand it, you should read the documentation. But really, why? Because the first time, they can give you another, well, type of interface. So this is not good. And this is much better. This is Vagrant. What they say is, well, options and a command, and optionally you can give it some additional arguments. So if you just give it a command, that's already fine. Well, you can say, well, let's start with the version. And what you see here is that the commands also really say what they are doing. So version, then I expect it to show the version. Or snapshot, then I expect it to create a snapshot, or at least I can do something with the snapshot. Halt, it's stopping. Connect, it's connecting to the system. It makes sense. And this is simplicity in a good way. The only thing I found confusing is when I start a machine, I give it an up to say start up the system. So I would expect if I would shut it down, then give it a down. But that's not the option they have, so they say, well, you should use alt, or if you want to get rid of it, use destroy. But still, it's a good thing to see that more tools are being more flexible. Then a lot of text, but it's not simple, so it's actually a bad sheet. But the dev tool rootkit hunter is something I wrote in 2003, and at that time I didn't have much with simplicity. I thought more features is better, because that is what people ask. So one flag, two flags, and in the end, a lot of flags. With Linus, the auditing tool, I try to make changes, say, okay, just if you never run this software, you get this output, most likely then the first time user, you get at least some colors, and you get a command. You can say, okay, Linus, audit, and then do something, or show, and do something. So it makes more sense. On the left, well, where should you start? And of course, they added some options in the list, so that you have an idea on what to do, but still for a first-time user, should you do any configuration, or, well, what is the best option? It's not there. This is an interesting one, and I give you a few seconds to read it, from Hack News. What you see here is total confusion. So a big company, and we all know the name, they created a product, they released it. It came on Hacker News with a link to the website saying, well, this is the new product. And I looked at the product and I thought, I don't understand what it is. So I thought, well, okay, silly me, I'm not up to date. I guess I have to read a little bit more. But then I saw these kind of comments, and I thought, well, okay, so many more people are confused. And this is not a small company doing, well, their first time open source project. They did it many times. But for some reason, their marketing department created all kind of nice fuss, so that the technical users who should be using it don't even understand what it is. So this is complexity in a whole different way. And that's a shame, because if you cannot explain your product in an easy way, then most likely you will not be able to share it with your colleagues or your peers in the field. So it's interesting. Then I like some reading to keep up with new things, so that I'm not always stupid when seeing new sites. So I tried Safari, the online books subscription model of O'Reilly and other books. And I like O'Reilly and I like the other vendors. So I installed this app and another one, and I got this error. So, well, my account type was not supported, whatever that means. So this is an error which is very useless. What I also noticed, it said 2012. So for some reason, even this thing didn't get updated. So I guess you have, or you need a prehistoric account of long, long ago. Then maybe you can use this. But that didn't, that wasn't said at the description of the application or the Android app. So that was maybe the first mistake. They should have said, well, you have two versions. If you're on a new type account with this name, then you should use this one and otherwise. So well, this is the first thing. And this is the second thing, because this is the right app. And as you can see, I found it to be a book. But when I want to read, especially with a physical book, I want to, well, open it and we'll start reading. You would expect that from a book. But a digital book, you would expect the same. Enough applications where you can directly start reading. But not with Safari, because you first have to search for it. Okay, fine, I found the book. That's the book I want to read. Then you have to say, okay, add it to my queue, because you found it in the search, and then you have to move it to your personal queue, to your bookshelf. And if you also want to read it, then you should download it. So that's the add and save for the first line. And it's very slow. So after a few minutes, you get timeouts. And then I don't want to read anymore. So really they failed. And actually they failed in a way that I got tired of it. I renewed once my subscription, but I thought, well, if we keep paying these companies for this kind of bad service, we actually do them a favor, so we should stop. So I canceled my subscription, even although I like O'Reilly and the other.
So. In my experience, it's always fast. My experience.
Not my experience. Okay. This is an interesting thing of complexity, and there's a name for it. That graph we have all seen in presentations or in management reports or in some applications. They have just, well, graphs which don't make sense. And this is an extreme version where you see just the data and it starts with 1 plus 2, 4, 8, 16. But you wouldn't see that directly from this graph. And especially, well, if you use bad colors and combine it with the axis incorrectly, the data itself is not useful anymore. So they put a stamp on it, so-called charge junk. So it's an interesting term. If you see ever a colleague creating a nice graph, that you can say, well, this is charge junk, and send them to these pictures. Well, as said, as part of doing security and development, I want to make software easier for myself and especially for my users. So we thought about it and said, okay, how can we make software easier to use? And, what does it mean? And the answer is you have to find out where pieces of complexity reside. And some you cannot avoid because it's a technical field. So jargon, the abbreviation, for example, is something which complicates things. And sometimes you can just spell out things, but for some terms, you have to just use the common jargon. It's saying, well, we accept like DNS. If you're technical, typically you will understand that. So you don't have to specify everything. But fighting those little pieces of complexity will help. And I came up with three main points of how to achieve it. And it's interesting, especially also with software. First impression is everything. It's like the Apple website. If you see it for the first time, you think, okay, this is a nice, clean website. What you see nowadays is that, especially the new companies, the startups, they all have that clean look because they use the same templates and websites got easier. Simplicity is especially with how to use the software, how to use the website. Instead of having to click many times, it's like what Amazon does. Just one click, give people the shortcut. They have limited time, so that helps. And what I see is, and there's the last one, which is a very important one, many tools, they give you output, but they don't tell you what to do with it. So they run and they say, well, we found 3 errors. Okay, fine. What should we do with it? Or they give you actually the 3 errors and say, well, this is wrong, this is wrong, and this is wrong. But it doesn't tell you, well, what can you do now to fix those errors? And they might give you a tip, like, or a hint saying, well, you can look in the log file, for example, to find out why. And the same with the useless error of Safari. They say, well, your account type is not supported. They could at least give me a link saying, this is maybe caused by, here's a link to see why you get this particular error. And that's something useful also in our work and the things we create. To keep an eye on, if you give an error, for what reason, they should always give that next additional step. Because it's annoying for a user to find out that you have, well, some kind of exception, but not, you don't know, should I turn back, should I do things again? Obviously, that's what we all do as technicians. We should retry the command, and then we hope that it suddenly gives us another answer. But still, if that would be the solution, like saying, okay, we cannot fulfill this at this moment, please retry, then you have actually already the next step, so you know what to do. That's a simple thing to do. So, regarding open source, I found a few ones, and with Toby in our midst, he might be finding similar things. A good description is the first impression. If you tell what is this project about, what will you achieve with it, who is the audience, should we be really technical or not? By giving just that good description, people can make the decision, should I use this or not? Like what you typically would do if you go to GitHub and you see a project which is updated 4 years ago, that's also some kind of description saying, well, this software is not updated in a very long time, I will skip it. So so that's a good start. Also a get started document. You see more and more projects getting now, okay, you're a new user, let's start there, and getting started document helps. Colors, color output if you can use it. Also with Shell script and with Python you can use colors, so even your scripts can be fancy. And things like the next step, the show the log file, show a link, show the action, what you can do. If you look at what we can do in our personal lives, and I will wrap up things, but if you'd like to discuss later on, I will be here. So definitely do that. The 3 main things I see is if you want to make things easier also in your personal life, go for these 3 steps. First, identify what you have in materials. Like on this desk, there's a lot of stuff, so I first need to identify what is laying around here and is it really needed. Then I would reduce what's not needed. So I see 3 or 4 glasses. I would say, well, I only need 1, so I can get rid of 3. And this other stuff is not needed. So that would be the next step. And in the end, organize. And I see, there's a Raspberry Pi there that's organized. It's already in the corner. It's not in my way, so that's a good place. But this is what you can do, and I will skip this one. And I did it lately on my mobile phone, because it's it's a blessing and also the devil in your, well, in your pocket. It takes a lot of time, and we look at Twitter and other kind of things, Facebook. We check it many times during the day. But what I had was, well, many apps, of course, like we all have. And then I could swipe on different screens. So I decided, okay, I want just one screen, because I don't want to swipe anymore. And I only want the applications which I use often. But then there's the thing still of the, well, the interruptions and wasting time. So I thought, okay, I have a few apps which are good. Those are marked green, these four. Those are the things which don't waste a lot of time. Like you use WhatsApp also today for the organization. Even although I get sometimes a message, it's not wasting a lot of time. So it's a good way to communicate. But I have also the online with Netflix and with NPO app and with Twitter. Those are the time consumers. So I made it red to remind myself of I should use this only when it's appropriate. So these are the small tips you can apply also on your phone. Say, okay, how can I be more more aware of the situation and not deal with my phone all the day? And what I found was sleep. It's, we never give it enough attention, so that's why it has its own icon still. A few other last tips, if you like, well, simplicity, there's still a lot of more things to learn about. There are two resources I like. The first one is Zen Habits. It's, it has now uncopyright, so you can use the blog and you can even sell the materials, you can do everything with it. But it's very generous of the author. And there's the Laws of Simplicity by John Nega. And it's a free book you can download. It has 10 simplicity laws on yeah, different areas which you can learn from. And it's, although it's 10 years old, it's still very applicable. So thanks, and enjoy the conference.